I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Chased by the deep state, fighting for independence, thinking about revolution, looking for alternative solutions. The enemies of the deep state will tell you what others even don't dare to think. Manuel Ochsenreiter and Mateusz Piskorski.
Hello, hello, hello. This is the next edition of the podcast, DieGutenMenschen, Public Enemies of the Deep State. My name is Manuel Ochsenreiter. I'm editor-in-chief of the German news magazine Zuerst. And on the other side is again my friend and colleague Mateusz Piskorski from Poland. Hello, Mateusz.
Yes, hello, hello from Poland.
So we have dramatic news from Poland, Mateusz. I heard that Poland invaded by accident Czech Republic. What happened?
It was not an accident. It's the beginning of the Third World War. Well, we have a great success because the Polish army has taken a small chapel in the hills on the Czech side. So we have a first military success of the contemporary Polish armed forces, and we are really proud of it. So this is not an ordinary day for me. This day we will remember till the end of our lives, I guess.
I have prepared something for this. I took an empty glass with me because we should announce this in a far better way, like. Achtung, Achtung, here are the news from the Polish front lines. So you can then always tell what our Polish heroes are doing there. By the way, it happened also already to Germany that we accidentally conquered Czech Republic, as you know.
You mean 1938, yes?
Yes.
Don't forget that the Polish troops were also there. Taking Czechoslovakia from the other side.
One victory after the other. How does that feel?
But Manuel, we are even better because the current invasion of Czech Republic by Polish armed forces is the third one in contemporary history. Because, you mentioned 1938,
yes.
But we had also our 1968,
yes.
When together with our Soviet friends, we have invaded Czechoslovakia as well.
And by the way, East Germany also joined there.
Yes, that's true. So, Germany and Poland are the most skilled and experienced invaders of Czechoslovakia, of Czech Republic.
Of course, the Soviets wanted to have some guys with experience on that kind of battlefield.
that's why you shouldn't doubt in our military success this time.
I am very feverish following all these events. I am just a little bit afraid that Prague might call in Bhutan, because we know the Bhutanese Air Force is still very angry with Poland.
Well, they have declared war to Poland, yes, so the situation is quite dangerous now, because as we see, the Czechs are already starting their negotiations with the Bhutanese. And this is the real problem.
But wait when the German eagle is waking up.
Yes, we really count on the German support.
Yes, the German eagle is waking up. And shall I tell you something? You know what makes our podcast really unique?
Well, a lot of things make it really unique.
But I think we are the only geopolitical podcast discussing this military great success of Poland in such a length.
The Bhutanese danger as well is, I think no one knows about it except us, yes?
I think we should make it a good tradition to remember and to remind in every podcast we do of the Bhutanese danger.
To make people aware of what might come in the coming months. Yes,
the wild hordes from the east.
This is the greatest danger. Not Russia, not China. We have to explain that to all the Atlantic, camp of the contemporary European politics. Yes. It's Bhutan.
Yeah, and Bhutan, we are watching you. Yeah.
Yes, and we are really aware of what you are doing there.
Mm-hmm. but today, we do also a little bit, I think, educational podcasting. We will speak about the party system and the two major and most powerful political parties in the United States. Since in Europe, if we watch the media, one would believe that there is something like a real competition and that it is about real contradicting political aims between the U.S. Democrats and the U.S. Republicans. And we have very soon coming again U.S. American elections. And today we will talk a little bit about this competition. Do you think what are the main, as you see, when we speak about military, I start speaking German. Hauptunterschiede, I wanted to say. What are the main differences between the U.S. Republicans and the U.S. Democrats? I mean, beside that, the one took an elephant and the others took a donkey as their party animal.
Well, do you see any differences? Because it's really hard to notice. now people are so emotional. I don't know. Have you sent any kind of gift or at least best wishes to Donald Trump when he had his birthday? Just a few days. No, you have.
No, I forgot it.
Anyway, for me it was an opportunity to think about those differences. I mean, actually non-existing differences, because I have asked myself and some of my colleagues also from the US some basic questions, and when those people, particularly on the European right, which are fascinated by Donald Trump and his pseudo-conservative rhetorics, I've noticed that people are really fascinated by the fact and impressed by the fact that Donald Trump hasn't started any war. Mm. Do you share this fascination and estimation of him? Because it's really hard to find any other president of the United States who hasn't started any war.
I would go even deeper, since... I mean, let us be honest, since Donald Trump entered the White House, U.S. politics became also very entertaining and surprising. Who would have thought that Donald Trump will meet the North Korean leader? Who would have dared to do it before? So he brought a lot of surprises. And on the other side, I think the rhetorics of Donald Trump are far more aggressive if we look at his Twitter posts and so on, than the rhetorics of any other U.S. president. If we see how Barack Obama or also Bill Clinton presented themselves as liberal soft angels of peace, but in reality they were sending a lot of cruise missiles, while Donald Trump is not doing that. So I see there that he's on the one side serving the sentiments of those who want to have a strong guy and threatening and saying this is the red line and you are the rocket boy and we will destroy Iran, but on the other side he's not doing it, and that is very interesting to me.
Don't forget that they are committing the acts of state terrorism everywhere. I mean, this year it has begun with the killing, I mean, a terrorist attack and murder of General Qasem Soleimani in
Iraq. Absolutely, absolutely, yes. But this is not a new development of Trump. This is, I think, what the United States are doing since decades. So he didn't start it. We can accuse him that he didn't stop it. But if we look, for example, we all followed this ridiculous military or wannabe military maneuver in Venezuela not so long ago. Do you think that any other president would have sent some, some hillbillies in uniforms of a private military company to do that, or they would have sent their whole fleet? I'm not sure. So I don't share this fascination of Trump that he didn't start a war like a lot of conservatives say, but I have to say, compared to Democratic presidents, he is someone who is doing, or obviously doing, far less real aggressive acts while he's doing a very aggressive rhetorics at the same time.
And he gives us a lot of entertainment. That's what I agree with.
I'm very thankful, America.
But on the other hand, look at Joe Biden. I mean, the candidate of the so-called Democrats. He's also quite funny. I mean, when it comes to some of his statements, for instance, he vocally supports the protests now all over the US. Yes. And we hear that from a guy who is representing the biggest corporations of the world, yes, and they have this interest. It also sounds quite funny. So anyway, I really envy the Americans.
Yes.
Their politics is so funny and entertaining, yes?
But you know, if I compare these two, Trump seems to me, we all know this old guy in the gym. You know who I mean? There is always in the gym the old guy in his 60s who wants to know it again and who is obviously totally on steroids.
Yeah.
So that is Trump. Yeah, he's like this funny guy. And then we all know the creepy grandpa from the neighborhood.
Yes.
That is somehow Biden. Yeah, creepy Biden. Biden,
yes,
somehow. Yes.
But in terms, you know, because people are now speaking about, and you know, there were some gossips about the so-called patriotic camp within the Republicans and so on. Yes, so they have even claimed that now, for instance, people are really amazed and I would say inspired by the speech of Trump in one of the military academies at West Point, yes, in
yes.
U.S., where he called for more isolationism and so on, yes. But on the other hand, I mean, he was talking about the military interventions. On the other hand, he does everything. I have also analyzed that. His administration does everything to, make the multipolar world impossible, which means that they are imposing another sanctions against Russia, another sanctions or even a kind of economic war against China. Now we hear that they are even going to sanction Germany and some German politicians and companies just for their participation in Nord Stream project. Then they have just claimed, I mean, the Republicans, not the Democrats, the Republicans have just called for another huge set of sanctions against Iran.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, so this is an aggressive and imperialist politics. I mean, this is not the matter. There's no difference if they will attack some country with their soldiers or private military corporations or with an economic attack or economic blockade. The Trump administration and the Republicans of Trump are just using little different methods and ways to let's say, prevent the creation of multipolar world, in my opinion. This is not the question of strategy, perhaps, but a question on the level of tactics. They are using different tactics to achieve the same goal.
I would like to answer on this, because I think that really hits the core of American politics. I would answer on this that American policy and The reason of state of the United States of America is the establishment of a unipolar world. I think that whoever is governing in the White House, whoever is defining American, if we can speak about this, American national identity or American mission, in what direction ever we are going there, it has always expansionism, it has always the urge for dominating others. They wouldn't call it dominating, by the way, they would call it then liberating others, so spreading their so-called values. I think whoever is governing in the White House has this in the genetics, in the genetical code of U.S. American policy. They do it then maybe in a different way, but I mean, I was reading something very interesting, that already in the 90s, the White House strategists from both camps, from the neocon camp and from the, let us say, the more isolation, these English words.
Isolationist.
Oh, danke schön. Thank you. From this camp are speaking about world inner politics when they mean in reality foreign relations. So I think this is a thing any American president of any American political camp will do. Of course, ideologically more directed in their way. There is a difference than if a conservative or ultra-liberal is there. But still, they cannot simply stop at their borders. Yeah, this is what I think about this. So the American politics in itself doesn't accept the multipolar world.
So you think that even if people like Ron Paul or Rand Paul, to a lesser extent, from the Republican Party, or, for instance, Bernie Sanders from the Democratic Party would become presidents, they would also continue this policy, yes?
Yes, I think that.
Yeah, because and here we come to the idea of the so-called deep state or deep government, yes? I mean, I always recommend to all those people who think that Trump or whoever who is a president of the United States sitting there in the White House decides about the strategic dimensions of U.S. policy, I recommend everyone who thinks so to read the very, very old book from the 1950s, written by Charles Wright Mills, Elites of Power. That was the name of the book. And in this book, back then, 60, almost 70 years ago, he has analyzed the personal, let's say, shape of American elites, and he came to a conclusion that there are just 500 families or clans governing the U.S., not necessarily being the presidents or secretaries of state, but just the true decision makers there, yes? Mm-hmm. So I think this is the same now, and yes, I agree with you that regardless who is actually a president of the U.S. and what he writes on his Twitter, because sometimes he might even write something very reasonable on his Twitter account, as Trump does sometimes, nothing will change, yes, because this is the very deep nature of the U.S. policy. So here we come to a conclusion that for us, there is only a small, let's say, aesthetical difference between the Democrats and the conservatives, between the one old guy and the second old guy. Yes, I mean you have perfectly characterized and described the style of each of them.
Yeah, and but you know, when I see now Biden versus Trump, I think we would have with both a lot of fun.
Yes, definitely. And I really like to see some debates between them, yes.
But you said something very important when it came to Trump and his policies against Russia and against Iran, and the policy of the White House against any moves towards a multipolar world. I don't agree fully to this. I agree that these moves
are done to prevent the multipolar world. But what do you think? If we look now to Europe, and if we look for example, especially to Germany, where we had, or I think we still have, a U.S. ambassador who is behaving really like an occupation officer or like a colonial lord or so.
You mean the chief of U.S. National Intelligence, Richard Grenell, I believe.
Yes, Dick Grenell, and I think isn't he at the same time also some coordinator on the Balkans, or he's
multifunctional. I mean, he's
a man of and he's doing the best parties in Berlin, of course. Yeah.
So, I have heard that.
Yes. So
I have never visited such a party, but this is not the milieu I would like to meet there in Berlin. But anyway, I have heard
the man of the strawberry cocktail, as we say.
Yes. So,
but still, I mean, the presence of this man made it almost impossible in Germany, even for the political mainstream, to express openly and without the urge to defend yourself a pro-American sentiment. Germany, by the sentiment, now not in economy and politics and so on, this is something else, but the anti-American sentiment, and what is always also a little bit like a sovereignist sentiment, because you cannot say we have to get a bigger distance to the US without saying, well, we have to take care about our stuff much better than we did until now, because we always believed the Americans will do this. So, in fact, I think that what Trump is doing, and that Trump politics is doing far more for the creation of a multipolar world than a nice democratic president, and I mentioned already, like Barack Obama or Bill Clinton, who make a pro-America, or who call for a pro-American sentiment. And unfortunately, it works in Europe. You know how the people are. They love then... Do you remember when Bill Clinton started playing saxophone, that this was more powerful than any programmatic speech of this man? So these are the facts, and this is the reality.
You mean the personal soft power, personal
yes,
soft power.
Yes, exactly.
Well, of course, I see a huge difference between Barack Obama, who, as I remember, came to Berlin after being elected, and he was greeted there by, I believe, hundreds of thousands of Germans. Yes,
Mateusz, wrong. He came to Berlin before he was elected president and had hundreds of thousands.
He was a candidate, yes.
I was back then a little reporter for a weekly newspaper in Berlin. I went to this event. Mm-hmm. It was at the Siegessäule, you know, at this parliament center in Berlin. Barack Obama was just candidate of the Democratic Party, and he delivered there a speech, and there were whole school classes coming with buses, and they were cheering to Barack Obama. And Barack Obama back then, I mean, his message was something like, yes, and we have to share more the power and the responsibility.
And by the way, sorry to interrupt you, has he used the words benign Berliner?
I'm not sure, but he said something like this and opened opened our hearts. Yes, of course.
Yes.
But what was interesting, all the school classes were cheering up, and Barack Obama was speaking there. And you know what it means when an American president goes to Europe and says, oh, guys, let us share responsibility. It means, guys, you have to send your troops with our troops. Yeah, and you have to spend more money for NATO.
For our weapons, yes.
Yes, exactly. So... And I was later on asking the school classes, and I said, why are you so amazed, and what was so amazing? And they said, I my English is not so good, but, you know, and he's a young black man, and it is so great. So that is how the things are. And as I said, he wasn't even president back then.
Barack Obama international style and image was standing between Catholic Pope and Dalai Lama, I guess. I mean,
yes, but the recent Catholic Pope, Francis.
Yes, of course, Francis.
Not our beloved Polish Pope.
Yes, I think not the one. Yes, and not Ratzinger as well.
Oh, of course not. But since we are an educational podcast, and since we have masses of young listeners, maybe it is also interesting when we speak already about the competition of the Democratic and the Republican Party, what only a few people know today, and I think especially in Europe, is that in the beginning, the Democratic Party used to be the conservative, the more backwarded party of the South States, and that the Republican Party actually was the party of slavery abolition and of the progressive industrial party. I think not so many people know this today, and that, of course, even most members of the Ku Klux Klan in the 1920s and 30s were members of the Democratic Party.
Well, I think that's why Nancy Pelosi stood on her knees for so long.
Yeah, we could. We should invite her and ask.
Yes, that would be a good idea. But hopefully we'll have some other guests from US.
Yes.
Won't tell about that today, but it should be a surprise, yes.
Absolutely. But I think it's very, very interesting to see this kind of transformation if we look at these two parties today and at their image. But I have also a question. If you compare the Republican Party of today, I mean, it's the party of President Donald Trump, with the Republican Party maybe 10 years ago. Do you think they are very similar, or didn't they really become some kind of, I don't know, with what we can compare them, like a more populist formation, a more maybe a little bit like the Hungarian Fidesz or so? Do you think it is legit to compare there, or how do you see this process of the Republican Party under Trump?
Well, I think that the party has several factions, and it also used to have several factions within, yes, and it's very, very divided, but of course, Trump could be compared when it comes to style, when it comes to intellectual skills as well, I guess, to Sarah Palin from the faction of Tea Party, of Tea Party some years ago, yes? I mean, that style is sometimes quite similar, I think, if we look for some similarities.
Do you remember how she said she knows Russia very well because from Alaska she can see Russia?
Yes, that was but by the way, as we are now invading the Czech Republic,
yes,
I would like to remind you that Sarah Palin was one of the inspirers and predecessors of the idea of invading the Czech Republic. I don't know if you remember the story when there was some terrorist attack in Boston. No, in the U.S.
And the attack
was prepared by some Chechen immigrants there in U.S. And then there was a speech of Sarah Palin of the Tea Party, of the Republicans, where she called for bombing Islamabad. That's obvious. Regardless, that Pakistan is their ally, or was their ally then, back then. But Islamabad, of course, sounds Islamic, yes?
Of course, she knew
one of the capitals of the axis of evil, Tehran. So she called for bombing Tehran. And the third city she called for massive bombardment was Prague.
Achtung, Achtung.
you know why? Because she has mistaken the Chechens with the Czechs.
Come on, that's close enough.
Pure people in Czech Republic were terrified. So, but that's quite important now, because they have to understand that the Polish commander in force president of our country has a lot of friends in the former Tea Party and in the ranks of the Republicans. So beware, Czechs.
And we shouldn't forget that there is the Fort Trump in creation in Poland. So
of course,
the reinforcements are coming.
In creation. So if Poland won't manage to solve the Czech problem now, it will definitely manage everything as soon as Fort Trump is built.
For the German side, I can assure you that we will just sit there and watch and will not interfere.
No. You have already gave a lot of support for Polish military plans, because as far as I know, you are going to send around 10,000 US soldiers to our country from Germany. Thank you very much for this kind and generous gift.
Yes, and don't forget the more generous gift. We left you the whole German East, so you can do the formations of your troops there to attack Czech Republic. How would you do that?
The topic becomes more we promise our listeners. Okay, let's ask our listeners for the next time if they want to have a quarrel and a conflict between a German and a Pole here in our podcast. If yes, then let's do it.
Yes, and let's take then from both sides one bottle of vodka or any kind of schnapps, and always when we touch a historical topic, we have to take a shot.
Yes.
or even
two.
Yeah.
But Manuel, back to our main topic today. The question is, in my opinion, yes.
Yeah.
Who will control the situation now? I mean, when it comes to the protests in the U.S., because as we have heard, it's Obama as well as Biden and so on. They are now trying to take control of the protests, which really sounds absurd, yes. But they are now trying to, create their image as something like a protest party, yes, I believe. Mm-hmm.
But on the other side, do you? That is always when it comes to the society of the United States of America. And I think within the last presidential campaign, we learned a lot, and we learned a lot about totally wrong understandings of American society. If you remember, if you were watching European media, you got the impression that Donald Trump will have maybe 5 to 10% of voters and all the rest will vote for Democrats. And so I think the whole European mainstream media and mainstream politics were really taught a lesson that they are totally wrong and that this is wishful thinking. Do you think that these protests will have such a huge effect on the elections? Because this is where I'm not sure, we have all these people who are voting for Trump in the central states of the United States of America and the Bible Belt in the more conservative. Of course, these people are not going to protests and they are not participating in anything. So do you think that these protests will have such a big effect on the elections in November?
No, but I unfortunately think that the elections will have an effect on the protests. So on the opposite, I think that unfortunately the Democrats are doing more and more to create a kind of ethnic, racial, cultural war instead of a social conflict, which originally it was a social conflict, yes, and now the Democrats are trying to use or abuse all the situation in to achieve their own electoral goals in their campaign. And on the other hand, and this is actually the goal, both American parties, both parts of the American establishment are trying to achieve now. I mean, they are trying to destroy the huge potential of the social protests.
Yes.
In my opinion. I mean, on the one hand, of course, Trump uses, let's say, traditional methods like Secret Service and so on and so on. On the other hand, the Democrats are trying to, make those protests, reshape them from social protest, from a class protest to a racial protest, to a cultural protest, yes. And that's why to destroy it. I mean, mm-hmm. It is because of this democratic rhetorics It is because people like Biden, like Obama and consorts, that a lot of whites in the US now will not be willing and able anymore to join the social protests. Yes, because they perceive them as racial ones, as Afro-American ones, yes, and so on. So I think this is the problem. And this is another proof, in my opinion, that both parties, the Democrats, the Republicans, are trying to achieve the same goals, not only externally, as you have stressed, but also internally. They are representing the interests of huge corporations and of the neoliberal system.
They have no interest at all in changing the system there, both parties.
Of course.
I think that is the point.
They have interest in preserving the system.
Absolutely, and they will both do the maximum. They will fight to the last drop of blood to first, as you correctly said, to distract from the social topics and to put it to the racial topic on the one side, and on the other side to use, as you mentioned with Trump, Secret Service, police, and so on to oppress that. I totally agree. And if we would have now a Democratic president, I'm almost sure that he would first try to put himself at the tip of the movement, and if this would not succeed, he would also use police, military, secret service, and so on to disintegrate the movement.
Of course, I remember that in 1999, yes, in Seattle as well, there were protests, I think first huge protest against WTO summit.
Yeah.
Back then, so it was 21 years ago, and if I'm not wrong, I think that the US president then was Bill Clinton.
Mm-hmm.
At the time, yes. Yes, exactly, it was Bill Clinton, and they have suppressed all the protesters with equal brutality as they do it now, and it was also in Seattle, by the way.
I have for the end of this podcast an inspiring utopia idea, or I would like to discuss with you. Imagine an American administration with Donald Trump as president and Joe Biden as his vice president, and Bill Clinton as, I don't know, minister for youth or whatever, you know, where he proved a lot of talents. Wouldn't that be great? I mean, wouldn't that be the maximum level of entertainment?
Yes, and hopefully we would have them some live transmissions and online negotiations between them, yes?
Yes, absolutely. You know, I can imagine how Trump would put these little yellow post-it papers for Joe Biden, where he writes like first pants, then jeans, or, you know, these mean messages and so on. I think that would be really the maximum of power of entertainment of the White House.
Yes.
But unfortunately, it will never become true.
Exactly, because I think personally that we in continental Europe should look at the American politics as entertainment. Of course, analyzing also it from the geopolitical point of view, but not, I mean, it's not worthy to waste our time to analyze some things which are just, not very serious, some tweets and so on. But it's better to analyze the decisions, yes, the real decisions taken there and the real moves taken by the U.S., and let me say some last words in this podcast. I think that really shouldn't be too emotional when it comes to American politics, because sometimes, particularly in times like now during the protests and so on, I think that too many Europeans, also from the, let's say, anti-system circles and so on, are too much full of emotions about the American debates and American politics. We have our own problems, and an appeal to our listeners, don't emotionally live in the US because we are living in Europe.
This program was presented to you by Manuel Ochsenreiter and Mateusz Piskorski, the hottest dissident who won't violate any time the global rules against racism, extremism, or any other bad isms.